Good afternoon. I think this is a great time to talk about dung beetles after a heavy lunch. All will be very happy to hear about dung beetles. So, yeah, today I'll be talking about the true dung beetles, the Scarabinae. If you look at the beetles which you encounter in dung, there are many beetles which belong to many different families. Some among them are here. So the Geotrupidae, which is the like the common name is the earth boring beetle. It is found in dung, but it is also like it nests under the ground and it uses the litter, leaf litter, for nesting. But most some of the time it is also coprophagous. Next, coming to Hysteridae. This is commonly called the clown beetle or the hyster beetle, and it is a predatory beetle which is found in dung. So it is not coprophagous. What it does is it feeds on the other beetles in the dung. Coming to Hydrophilidae, this like common name is aquatic scavenger beetle, but it is not completely aquatic. Some of them are found in dung. The larvae is predatory and will feed on the other larvae found in dung, but the adults are coprophagous. Coming to Staphylinidae or the row beetles, the predatory nature, and they will feed on the other beetles in the dung. The Ephordinae and Scarabinae, these are the subfamilies of beetles found in dung. They belong to the same family, Scarabinae. Now coming to the taxonomic hierarchy of Scarabinae, they belong to order Coleoptera, family Scarabinae, and subfamily Scarabinae. These are the two dung beetles. And the functional groups are the rollers, panellers, dwellers, and the kleptoparasites. This according to the way in which they translocate the resource, that is the dung. But if they are called the true dung beetles, these are found only also in the carcasses, that is the dead and decomposing substances and the fungus. And the rollers, what they do is they take away the dung or the like dead and decomposing substance, and they take it a few meters away and they bury it under the soil. And the tunnelers, they will tunnel just under the dung. See here, the rollers will take away from the dung pad and they'll take it away for some meters and they'll bury it under the soil. While the tunnelers will bury it just under the dung. And the dwellers, they will stay in the dung and they will make their nest inside the dung itself. So why they carry away this dung is just not only for feeding but also for eating. So inside the tunnels, they will make nests and they will make brood balls. In each brood ball, they will lay their eggs. So whenever they take away the dung, you will see that there are a pair of dung beetles. So mostly the male and the female, they both of them join to make this nest. So the male will roll away the dung ball and the female will just sit on top of the ball. While in burrowing, the males are the ones who will like burrow under the soil mostly. And also in some species there is parental care. While coming to the kleptoparasites, these are the beetles which will lay egg in the brood balls of other dung beetles. So some species, particularly some genus are there which are kleptoparasites. So the ecological functions, coming to the ecological function of dung beetles, they are decomposers, they help in nutrient cycling, they help in bioturbation, secondary seed dispersal and parasite suppression. So decomposers, like they will help in decomposing the decaying substances, and while they take the dung under the soil, they help in nutrient cycling. Bioturbation is like they help in changing the nature of soil. When they bury and bring out the underground soil, they help in bioturbation. Then secondly, it disperses many herbivores which feed on plant materials. Along with their food, they take in this seeds also. So when the dung beetles take away the dung of the herbivores, they take away the seeds also with them and bury them somewhere far away. Like this, it helps in secondary seeds. Parasite suppression is like many nematodes and the fly larvae which breeds in this dung. Like when the dung beetles feed them, feed on the dung, they are not allowed to breed in the dung. So coming to the external morphology of dung beetles, like Pranoy said, it's very difficult to identify them in the field. So what we have to know mainly about their morphology is like in the key characters you come across all these different taxonomic terms. So one should know about the Clypeus, the foreleg, the pronotum, the elytra, the elytral striae, and the pygidium. Mostly in the keys you find that they have different sculptures, different species have different sculptures. Also, some of the ventral characters you have to see are the metasternum and some of the spines will be visible on the legs of different species. So these are the 30 different genera. In Karnataka we have around 23 genera of dung beetles, and the common ones are listed here and some of the photographs are here. So these two are the rollers. You can see that they are long hind legs, and these are the tunnelers. Sorry, these three are rollers and these are the tunnelers. These two are the dwellers. So there are, know that it will be difficult for you to follow in such a short presentation all the keys, but still I have the keys for each of them. So it's an illustrated key and pictures will be there for each characters. So if the first of all we'll see how you can identify the rollers. So if the hind legs are longer than the mid legs, that is this hind leg is longer than this mid leg, then we can say that it's a roller. And among the rollers itself there are differences between the different genera. So if it is narrow bodied and the middle coxae, this is the coxae that is a part of the leg. So if the middle coxae is widely separated, you can see it's widely separated and this is close by. So if it's widely separated and the middle tibia has two terminal spur, this is the spur on the middle tibia, and if it is that, then you can say it is genus Cyphus. And if it is broad bodied and the middle coxae are not widely separated and the middle tibia has only a single spur, one terminal spur, then it can be any of this. That is, if the front tarsi are present, the tarsi, and if the tarsi is present and the elytra is excised behind the shoulder, here is the elytra, and if it is excised here, you can see the abdomen below, then it is genus Gymnopurus. And if the front tarsi is absent and the elytra is not excised, then it is Scarabaeus. So the next character you have to see is whether scutellum is present. So all the three genera of rollers we have identified. So if the scutellum, this is a scutellum, and if it is present and if it is absent, you have to first see whether the scutellum is present. The scutellum is present and there is a basal impression on the pronotum, then it is genus Onitis. So this is the basal impression. And if the pronotum is without two basal impression, then you have to see whether it has this fringe on the hind margin. So elytra is not fringed from the before the hind margin, it is Pleiotomus. Go back, and if the elytra is fringed before the hind margin, then you have to see whether the sides of the abdomen is exposed. If it is exposed, it is opportunity sellers. You know, it will be difficult for you to catch up all this so fast. We will see later under the microscope these species. So if the sides of the abdomen is not exposed above, this ibiodopan. So what we have to see now is whether the elytra is with two lateral carinae. This is the lateral carinae on the elytra. So if it has two lateral carinae, then it can be either heliocopris or catharsis. So if it is heliocopris, it has six elytral striae, which is the lines which you see on this elytra, and the first carina does not begin from the base. And if it is medium sized and with seven elytral striae, then it comes to catharsis. Now going to this carinae, you can see for heliocopris it starts midway, doesn't start from the base. In case of catharsis, it starts from the base. Both the carinae start from the base. Now elytra with only one lateral carinae, you can see that the pronotum is with a strong basal case of copris. So if it is with a strong basal groove on the pronotum, copris. So if the pronotum is without a strong basal and the mid and hind tarsi is broad and flattened, this is the mid tarsi and this is the hind tarsi. If it is broad and flattened, broader than this one, so it is phallops. And if the mid and hind tarsi is not broad and flattened, can be either of these two genus. And the terminal margins, these are two like similar looking genus. And if the terminal margin of the front tibia are at right angle to the inner margin, that is this part of the tibia, if it is right angle and the anterior margin of the prothorax is hollowed behind, it's not very clear here, but it will be hollowed in this part, then it is Cacobius. This is one of the leptoparasite dung beetle. So it lays eggs in the pods of other species. So if the terminal margin of the front angles are oblique or either like oblique, or if it is at right angle, then this pronotum, it won't be hollowed beneath in the pronotum. Then it is Ontophagus. Now coming to IBP, we have around 230 species pages in dung beetles, and you can find it under species in this book. So these are the species list. So, and these are the informations on the species pages. Like there will be species names, structural description, measurements, embodiments, different types, and also and yeah, it will be very difficult for a beginner to identify dung beetles in the field, and most of the time it will be difficult to notice them in the field. You might have seen those large ones like copris and catharsis which comes to light, some of the orthophagus. But in field, if you have to see a dung beetle, you will mostly see the rollers which rolls away the dung, or you have to lift up the dung or cactuses, find one dung. So if you find it and you want to know the real identification, you can either go to the species pages once you get familiar with the genera, or can write to me in my address.